not the professional artist of Prescott. It's okay. I'm curious. Yes.
I'll go first because I like you so much.
Oh, no. I like you too.
I'm happy because I want to share. But mine, I'll just, you can't see it from where you're sitting, I'm sure, but I'll describe it to you. It's a picture of her. And out in the surrounding and off in the distance, I have the words light and love and allness, and that surrounds everything.
Allness?
Allness.
Wonderful. Absolutely wonderful. Anyone else brave enough to show your stick figure drawing?
Show.
Yeah.
You really can't see it because it's very small.
It's right there. And talking about E.E. Cummings, I was reminded of when I was in high school and we named our lit mag after a line from one of his poems, Even the Rain. Mm. So I had a book with birds flying out of it and the birds were coming into hearts, and then there's rain and clouds.
Ooh. I guess. So, clouds. Yeah. Anyone else?
Okay, I'll be really brave. So I thought, oh my goodness, what can I do? And then I looked up and I saw what you had on the screen. Mm-hmm. And I falling, 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 exactly, falling, falling. And then I had this book on my table here, which is when women were birds. And then I thought of the soaring, soaring. So we have the falling and then the flight of soaring.
Very active. Thank you for sharing. I know that was, sometimes I think it's easier to share what we're not that great at than what we're trying to be great at. Kind of lightens the mood. So, forgive me, I'm not good at the PC. What are some of the pitfalls when writing about love? And this can be with several topics, but love is the one that I have chosen. So what are some of the pitfalls? Yes?
Clichés.
Clichés. What are some really good clichés you have heard about love?
It conquers all.
It conquers all. What was that?
Blah.
Some blah humbugs are rare.
I would love to just write a poem that says, love,
blah.
Perfection. Nailed it. Anyone else?
Roses are red.
Roses are red. Flowers. Flowery language. Very romantic, flowery language. What else?
Pitfalls to love.
The pitfalls about writing about love. They're different, right? Very different.
Talking about love, brightening a room or darkening a room.
Ooh, the light and the dark.
Yes, very overplayed. Mm-hmm. Yes.
It can sound trite and manufactured.
Absolutely. It can sound trite and manufactured.
That's the thing. So much has been written about love.
Yes, so much has been written about love.
So it's hard to be original.
It is hard to be original. It's hard to be refreshing. Right? It's hard to surprise your reader. I know somebody who does. E.E. Cummings. Would some brave soul like to read this poem out loud to the room? Not just in your head. Okay. Let me try.
Than recall, more seldom than a wave is what, more frequent than to fail. It is most mad and moonly, unless it shall unbe than all the sea, which only it's deeper than the sea. And I'm going to hand it off to somebody else.
Perfect. Last two stanzas.
I'll do it.
Thank you.
If I can read from here.
You can stand up if you need to. Yeah. Come on up.
Love is less always than to win, less never than alive, less bigger than the least begin, less littler than forgive. It is most sane and sunly, more it cannot die than all the sky, which only is higher than the sky.
Thank you. You can read all of my poetry from now on. That was beautiful. All right. So how does this poem make you feel?
Can we see it again? Can you go back?
I can go back, absolutely. I think I can go back.
You can.
Yes.
Thank you.
How does it make you feel?
Puzzled, like a lot of you said.
Puzzled. Perfect. A little baffled. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Makes me admire the color.
Yes, I do.
What do you admire? Anything specific in there that stood out for you that you were like, whoa?
Singularity. The singularity of his poetry.
Beautiful. Beautifully articulated.
There's a little cliche in there, deeper than the sea.
Yeah. Can we forgive that?
It makes me feel expanded.
Ooh, expanded.
I see the more, most, always, never, actually never, bigger, and then most, more, and then all, mm-hmm. higher.
Interesting. Very, very good. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The language is humble when you first look at it.
Yes.
The concepts are not. Mm-hmm. And so I feel liberated to write whatever I want to write about lots.
Ah, more from the heart. It's more raw emotion in there, right? Okay. I forget my second question. I have to move forward.
Do you want to hear what his figures of speech are? I mean, his words, the type of language.
Ooh, we're going to get there.
Oh, you are?
You are okay, stepping ahead. You're charging forward. Good. So I think the two questions, I believe, were combined, what did you feel and what did you notice, even though they're different experiences. So if anyone would like to share what they noticed, figures of speech, yes.
A lot of superlatives.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Anyone else? Yes.
I think when he's using the, like, more better or more, you know what I mean, when you're using the superlative with an ER, which you're, like, absolutely never supposed to do.
It's not robotic, right? It's not stale, it's not overused. It's fresh and it's alive and it's a little wild and a little weird. Right? Yes.
I like the way that he applies physical qualities to words, to like mental experiences that normally you don't think of in those terms, like, what was it, something about thickness and forgetting and something else about recalling, like I never think of those actions.
Mad and moonly.
Mad and moonly. Well, that is a bumper sticker. It is beautiful. All right, what do you think his goal was?
Simplicity.
other people. But the moment you feel, you're nobody but yourself. So I read this to my 9-year-old, this quote. He was doing Dremel writing and a little bit stuck, and I read that to him, and he went, oh my gosh, it's right. So, yep, you're right. His goal was to have you feel and to express the way that he feels as well. Let's figure out, there we go, what it's all about, how he does it. It's all about perception. So, how many, by a show of hands, know that E.E. Cummings was also a painter? Woo, yay! An absolutely beautiful painter. And his poems, he said, were actually poem paintings, or poem pictures. And the aesthetics that he has, the techniques that he used, are aligned in both painting and poetry. So he's trying to create the poem to do the same thing that a painting does. And we're going to talk a little bit about what that is. We're going to start with perception and what that means. He was big on perception. So it originates in raw sensations that one feels and becomes sensuously aware. Then one begins to perceive them. Right? So you enter at a sense level. Right? Not a level of logic or your past or what you already know, but what you feel with your senses. So what happens when you look at something you've never seen before? Or hear a word in a foreign language. Imagine meeting somebody for the first time. You do not have any preformed feelings or expectations. You experience that meeting on a sense level where the experience is fluid and whole. Can you think of any other time or example when your experience is fluid or whole and it's purely on a sense level?
You're walking through the woods and you're taking your time and you hear a strange noise in the distance.
Exactly what
happens. Surprises happened. You.
Mm-hmm.
It could be anything from fear to excitement. Depends on why you're there and how you perceive that sound.
Mm-hmm. So the first thing that happens is you feel, and then what's the second thing that happens?
Then you investigate.
Investigate. Good word. Mm-hmm. Anyone else? Any other experiences? For examples, how about falling in love?
Yeah.
Right? Do you feel first, or do you think, well, I mean, I guess maybe it's different with technology because you're reading stats and looking at a photo of somebody. Oh, they like this and that. But when you meet somebody in real life, right, do you get that feeling first, or do you do a checklist of, like, they're tall, they have dark hair, they have all their teeth? Depending on what you might enjoy. Don't pretend to know. Keeping it real.
Fluid and whole.
Yes.
How about good sex?
Fluid and whole. Yes.
So I was, when you were first explaining this, I was thinking that this is why we have so much awe with children, because everything for them is from this example, right? But then you started giving your physical examples.
Mm-hmm.
Do they bridge that?
It's an interesting question. Because of the way that a child's brain is forming, when it comes to curiosity and experience, I do not know the answer. I have small children, and I can guess that they feel intensely first, and then they work to apply logic to the experience. But it's different, I think, because their brains are still forming in different ways. So it's a good question. I think we'd have to bring in some brain development and neurology to fully answer. Yes?
I'm reminded of when a child sees or hears or experiences something for the very first time. They don't have the experience with that. They don't go into course correction mode.
Mm-hmm.
But we do, because it's like the old Mulligan David wine commercial that said, don't drink the wine you're supposed to like. Drink the wine you do like. And I think the older we get, the more we're aware of how our perception or our reaction is going to be perceived.
Beautiful. I like all the wine, so. back, they don't have a lot of the vocabulary yet, depending on what stage or age they're at. And so I think you could probably say that they experience it on the level of feeling and a sensory level, then they try to work to apply that logic or develop that logic. Beautiful. So, you start with perception, and the experience is fluid and whole, and then you move on to recognition, which interrupts, right? So, recognition follows perception and depends upon thinking to make sense by joining and filtering through memory. It blurs our perceptions, it loses the nowness of them, the full force of their immediacy. Recognition is concerned with simplifying our existence, reducing it to the lowest common denominator. So, and I love what you said, somebody said about the poem that it made them feel expansive and free. Right? It's the opposite of recognition. Recognition narrows down the field. So I can look at a painting of a chair, and if it's an abstract painting, I might experience it in the level of feeling first. And I'm blown away by the color scheme, by the shapes, by the different textures in the painting. But then my brain starts to go, what am I looking at? What is this object? Right? So when you sit down to write, how do you enter the writing? Do you enter with a thought, a logical thought, an idea, maybe a plot line or a quote? Or do you enter with a feeling? Can anybody answer that?
Well, that's sort of the point, isn't it?
Sort of the point. So, do you sit down to write when you feel something in your body, physically, when you feel it? Or do you sit down to write when you know something?
Are you asking me?
Mm-hmm.
Well, it's mixed up. It's feeling and thought. I guess I can have a thought that doesn't involve a feeling, but I don't think I can have a feeling that doesn't involve a thought. Unless you talk about a stomach ache, and I don't think you're talking about a stomach ache or something like that.
No, not an ailment. Yes.
I can sort of relate to this. Sometimes I have feelings that I don't understand where they come from. So I try to analyze why am I feeling like this.
Does writing help? Does anybody ever sit down to the blank screen or blank page without an agenda? Just, I'm going to sit down and write. No idea where it's going.
Yep.
One person?
Yeah.
So everybody, it's not wrong if you sit down with an agenda or you have notes or a book. Everyone's brain works differently. Everybody is a different personality type, a different way of perceiving the world and interacting with language and the world around you. I'm just curious to see what your process is like, because I guarantee we are all very different. Right? We may share some of the same tools.
Mm-hmm. I do a lot of pre-writing in my mind.
Ah, in your mind?
Yeah. Then I'll even edit that pre-writing before I ever put it down.
In your mind?
Yep. Oh. I think about it. Next day, think about it a little differently. I don't actually put it down until it's pretty well formed.
Hmm. Interesting. And now, do you think about it at the level of language, or do you think about it at the level of structure? As in, like, plot or story development, character development?
Good question. Probably because I write mostly poetry.
Mm-hmm.
It's structure.
Cool.
And then the vocabulary and the...
And it comes.
Yeah, the feelings and what I want to convey is added to the structure. Yeah.
Wonderful.
But I never thought of that before.
Yeah. So, this is an E. Cummings painting. What does your brain do? Like, see if you can sit back and be that, like, mindful observer of your brain or your body as you look at this. see it clearly now?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
You're looking for something to grab onto and build the rest of it in there so you can understand what it means.
So you're looking for the recognition. You want to put it into that knowable context.
Looks like a turkey carcass with the scribbles.
Yeah. Okay.
That's not what I see.
Yes.
I'm not trying to find an item in it, but I do try to find a path. So I try to see where does the eye flow, and then, because I'm a visual artist, I go, why does it flow that way?
Mm-hmm.
And so that's kind of my recognition is, where does my eye go? Why is my eye going there? Why does my eye go there next? And that's how I analyze the work.
Perfect. So for this next one I'm going to show you, I want you to, and this is really hard to do, I'm asking the impossible, stop your brain for just about 10 seconds and see if you can feel what's on the screen.
Something that grounds it. There is a grounding as well as all the movement.
What grounds you in this particularly?
The dark color.
Like a horizon?
A horizon, yes.
Okay. Anything else? Yes.
Looks like a scuba diver's view looking up at an oil at the bottom of an oil slick.
I love that. I would not have gone there, but I love that. Absolutely. Okay.
Dr. Timothy Leary.
All right, so.
Legend in his own mind.
In painting, his intention was that you see, feel, and those are smushed together because he wants that experience to be one fluid and whole. So your mind discerns the arrangement of colors, lines, textures, masses, and vacancies, then the objects, then the grounding object that you were searching for. Perception begins to fade as soon as you find that object you can relate to, that you can recognize. And then memory comes in to, quote, determine its place in the known universe based on its appearance, use, context, etc. Oh, hey, that's a vase with some dead flowers. And then your mind travels back to, I'm really terrible at keeping flowers alive. Remember that time I had those daisies in my kitchen? Or whatever association you have with that. So he is trying to postpone that association, that recognition, by approaching it from a level of feeling. Yes?
This reminds me of the thing I saw years ago. We've all seen the Rorschach ink blot,
yes,
right? What are they, how do you think our perceptions of those ink blots would change if they were different colors?
Do you think that feeling would come into play over trying to find recognition?
Mm-hmm.
That's a really interesting question. You could write a whole thing about that. Yeah. So, after you feel it becomes categorical thinking, the mind begins to group. The eye moves continuously through all parts of a painting in the phase of perception. So you're scanning, you're experiencing it as a whole, right? And then something will stop it as soon as you recognize it. Maybe you meet somebody you haven't seen in 10 years, you run into them at Fry's, and immediately you enter this in a sense of feeling, like, this feels familiar. Trying to get a feel for this person, and then your mind narrows in and says, oh, that's Bob. I owe him $20. Right? So.
It pays dues.
What's that?
It pays dues.
Yeah. It pays dues. That's right. So, for Cummings, with painting, as in with poetry, he viewed it as a process rather than a product. And through his innovative typography, which we saw, and vocabulary, he involves the reader in the process. The poem is, in the painting, right, essentially remade every time that you view it. It's a whole new experience. You're feeling something different. Right? Maybe you woke up grouchy. Maybe you woke up happy. Every time you access it, it's different. Does that happen frequently with reading?
All the time.
So how do we do that with writing? We're going to find out. All right, well, first we're going to talk about why it matters. I'm going to dangle the carrot first. So, as Cummings explained, familiarity breeds contempt. This means that the more we recognize an object in our mind, the less we see it with our eyes, the less we feel the experience of it. So what does this mean with creating images in writing, especially with love? Familiarity breeds contempt. Okay. Are you with me?
Familiarity, I would say familiarity breeds tedium rather than contempt. No.
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 What was your response? I could only hear the no. It's comfort.
It's like my sweatshirt.
But when you're talking about art, not so much like your sweatshirt or your chair, because I guarantee the more you break in a chair, the more comfortable it is, the more familiar you are with it. But when you're reading an essay, a short story, a novel, or a poem, if you feel like you've read it 1,000 times before, are you going to keep reading?
Yeah, it depends on what it is. There are some things that I'll go back to again and again and again. It's just, it is a deeper sense of appreciation.
Okay. Yeah.
Music is.
No, it's wonderful. Yes.
I do a lot of the advertising writing, radio commercials, and stuff.
Yes.
And I learned a long time ago the very hard lesson. If you try to write a commercial, it's very, very gimmicky with a funny punchline. It only works the first 2 or 3 times you hear it. Because after you hear it 200 or 300 times repeated, you hear the first couple lines and you tune it out and you
yes.
miss the part that may sell the product to you.
Mm-hmm.
Familiarity is contempt.
My children run around the house saying, Arby's, we have the meat, like 300 times a day. day. There's a lot of contempt there.
The exception to that, though, I think would be music.
Okay.
A particular group that you may like, you may listen to an album, dating myself with albums, but you may listen to an album 50 times and not get tired of it.
That's true.
So I think that goes against the familiarity breeds contempt. After a while, you can sit there and you know all the lyrics and still sing along with it. So.
But you're probably listening to it for different reasons. Maybe there's some nostalgia in there. Maybe there is comfort in there. Versus a lot of times when you are looking at art, maybe a painting, maybe you're reading a short story, you want to be startled. You want to be awake. You want to be surprised. Right? So maybe just, no, we don't. That's a horrible idea. All right, again. Well, I do. All right.
You think Cummings is saying about poem that once you become familiar with it, you don't like it anymore? No. You wouldn't be saying that.
What do you think? What if we table that question for...